Can't talk fast, just spit smooth rhymes. I'm usually overthinking with my mathematic mind. Let's press rewind and take it back. Go take it back to when I was younger. I could take the world under my arm and go farther than I thought I could. Now I'm a rider, not a fighter. I wanna love, I wanna show the world what I'm dreaming of. Breaking chains from the slaves and calling people by name, telling them they're worth it. We could change the earth if we try, try with just a little love. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We're the artists and the planet shakers. I don't know how to do this, maybe I've just been running my mouth lately, wondering how to take a stand. I'm just trying to be a better man. We'll change our mind if we take the time to listen, open up our eyes to something new, see what different people can do. Like remember when we were kids and trouble didn't seem so big. Let's see the world with wonder again. Never let those monsters win. We're taking down the big guys. We ain't giants, but we're reaching towards the sky, higher than they said we could. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things. We're the sculptors making shape, the poets turning phrases into weapons, big enough to make a difference. Though our voices may be small, we're breaking down the walls and we're lifting the broken up. Because we are the music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. Are here to change things.
Hello and welcome to Restoration Church. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are so thrilled that you are here. My name's Katie. I'm one of the pastors here at Restoration Church, and we are so excited to continue our series that we started a couple weeks ago called Ready for Restoration. And man, we had an amazing Vision Sunday last Sunday. Thank you for those of you who watched online, for those of you who came and joined us at the parking lot. It was an amazing time to just be together as one church in three different ways. We are so thrilled for the amazing things that God has in store for us in this next season. So as we kick off our gathering today, I want to encourage you to go ahead, open up the live chat right there to your right. You can log on, say hi to friends, say hi to people that maybe you've missed this week. You can engage in real time with what God might be teaching you, with what you might be experiencing in the moment. We know that there's many different ways that God can use your voice, that God can use your encouragement. So you never know who might benefit from hearing your thoughts posted in there as well. So we're going to prepare our hearts as we get ready to worship together. And we know that worshiping into a screen might feel different. For those of you who are new with us, this might be the first time attending church online. But we encourage you to push through whatever awkwardness or hesitation you might be feeling, to realize this is simply a way for our hearts to connect with God. A God who loves you, He's crazy about you, who went through and overcame all odds to be in a relationship with you. So as we sing, or maybe for you, even just letting the words be sung over you or meditating on the meaning of these words on the screen, just let this be a time for your heart to connect with God. So ready, church? Here we go. Let's worship.
Oh, what a Savior! Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. As you wait for your crown, tell the world of the treasure found.
Unreserved, unrestrained, your love is wild, your love is wild for me. It isn't shy, it's unashamed, your love is proud to be seen. To be seen with me, yeah. And you don't give your heart in pieces. And you don't hide yourself. Uncontrolled, uncontained, your love is fire, burning bright for me. It's not a spark, it's not just a flame, your love is light, and all the world will see. It hangs on every word you say. Love keeps its promises. It keeps its word.
Thank you so much for worshiping with us today and for joining us at Restoration Church Online. My name is Katie. I'm one of the pastors here at Restoration Church, and I'm so glad that you took time out of your day to hear from God, to worship together, to join us, whether you're meeting in a house church or whether you're watching on your own. We're just excited for what God is doing. Thank you for those of you who joined us last week for Vision Sunday, whether you were live at our parking lot gathering or watching online or in a house church. We were so encouraged by seeing our church as one church worshiping together in three different ways. So I'm excited to help you get connected in case you're new to our community, in case you've yet to get involved. I want to direct you to restorationchurchsd.com/live. Right there on that page, there's tons of amazing resources to help you get plugged in. And the first one is our connection card. Go ahead and fill out that connection card sometime today. Let us know a little bit about yourself, and someone from our team will reach out, help you get connected, and answer any questions that you might have. For those of you who might need to update your information, go ahead and make sure your information's current on there as well, because in the next weeks and months coming up, we're gonna have a lot of cool updates for you. We don't want you to miss out on what is going on here at our church. So as we shared this Sunday, we are gonna be stepping out during these new days to worship in some new ways. And some of the ways that we are gonna be navigating this new season as a church is by making all of our Sunday gathering content available on our YouTube page. So that way you can watch on demand whenever it is convenient for you. So live stream will still be happening, but you can also share all of our links to our YouTube page as well. We also shared last Sunday that we are going to be having our monthly gatherings right here in our parking lot every first Sunday of the month. So we'll celebrate communion, we'll worship together, much like we did this last Sunday. And then every third Sunday, we are going to be having our Restoration Kids Club. So we're going to be having all of our Restoration Kids content. All of the leaders are super excited to have some space that is intended just for our kids to learn, to worship, and to grow in a way that is age appropriate and tons of fun. So go ahead and mark your calendars for all of the first and third Sundays. For the rest of 2020, we want to make sure that you save those dates and you're a part of these exciting times. We also will still have all of our online content available. So don't worry, you can still be a part of it that way. So this fall, we have a lot of exciting things coming up. So be sure to mark your calendar for October 4th. That is going to be our first Sunday gathering here in our parking lot. We're going to kick it off with having life group signups, house church signups. So there's tons of ways to get connected, to dive in a little bit deeper into community. We know that many of you are also wanting to go a little bit deeper into prayer and discussion in your groups or in your house churches. So you'll notice at the end of our gatherings, we'll have some great resources posted for you to walk through some discussion questions, to walk through some prayer together in your groups, to help you go a little bit deeper, to really apply what it is we're learning each and every week. So check that out. We hope that is a gift for you as you dive a little bit deeper into how God is transforming you and growing you in this time. Well, we're excited to continue our series called Ready for Restoration, and Kurt is gonna be preaching an amazing message today. So thanks for tuning in. Kurt will be up in just a minute as we continue our series, Ready for Restoration.
Well, hey everybody, welcome to Restoration Church Online. My name is Kurt, I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm so glad that you have joined us as we're in the middle of a conversation that we began a few weeks ago called Ready for Restoration. We're navigating together this conversation around how do we even walk through this crazy year that we find ourselves in, and what might God have in store for us, for our faith, for our family, for our friendships, for our life, as we navigate what is by far the most upside down and inside out experience that many of us have ever had here in the year of 2020. Ironically, as much as we probably looked forward to the year of 2020 being this quintessential year of perfect vision, and now if we're honest, we're so upended that we wonder, what day is it even? But you know it hasn't been your week, your month, or even your year. You know, you used to have Friday and Saturday to go out or hang out at the ball club or go golfing. Sunday, you came to church as a family, and on Monday, you dropped your kids off at school, and they had their day, and you went out to the office, and you had meetings, and happy hour and lunches with coworkers, and now you're just excited to see the mailman or the Uber Eats driver because you just want some human contact. And the reality is that for all of us, this is our first global pandemic, but we have all experienced these kinds of transitional moments like this before at some point in our life. You have experienced a transition where, you know, things got shaken up and it became hazy and you couldn't see your way through. And we all know a couple things about transitions. We know that transitions always test us. And they always transform us. And I think that when we look back, when you look back, when I look back, if we choose to and tell the story of 2020, we will say God was actually up to something. And we actually discovered something new and important that was being developed on the inside of us, the eternal part of us, the eternal part of you in your soul. And for many of us, we would love for life to go in a linear fashion, like straightforward or up and to the right, and have clear goals and deliverables. But this year, for many of us, for you, I know for me, it has been upside down and inside out. And God often takes us the long way around because there's something He wants us to see. And as much as that kind of goes against our preferences, it's actually for our good and for our growth. The Israelites and their leader Moses actually are very familiar with this reality. You may have heard the story of Moses before. Maybe you've seen it on a Disney film, or you're aware of Moses, the leader of the Israelites in the Old Testament. But about 1,000 years before Jesus, this nation of Israel was enslaved in Egypt. And for 5 generations, they were making bricks, which was very, very difficult, backbreaking work. No breaks, no holidays. And finally, Moses comes to the leader and says, "Let my people go." And God does some incredible miracles. And they flee. And now they're wandering in the desert. And they're traveling from Egypt to Israel, which actually isn't very far. But it's taking them a long time. And where they have seen God move in some powerful ways, now they just find themselves circling and circling and circling in the wilderness. And they begin, like us, to get frustrated when they don't see the clear path forward. See, the Israelites, you know, had, again, for 5 generations, been enslaved in Egypt. And this was a challenging experience, to say the least, craving, praying, crying out to God for a savior, for someone to come and set them free, to hear their pain. And now they're 2.5 months in to their experience in the wilderness. And we're going to read in Exodus 16 that they're already complaining. They are afraid of the mystery of the non-linear journey that they find themselves in the wilderness. And so it says in Exodus chapter 16 that the whole nation of Israel journeyed into the wilderness of Sin between Elim and Mount Sinai. And they arrived there the 15th day of the 2nd month, which was 1 month after leaving the land of Egypt. And there too, the whole community of Israel complained about Moses and Aaron, the 2 men that were leading them, right, leading them to freedom. They were upset and they said, "If only the Lord had killed us back in Egypt," they groaned, right? "There we were around pots filled with meat and we ate all the bread that we wanted. And now you have brought us here into the wilderness to starve us to death." And you just hear their grumbling in this situation because they are now in a spot where they don't know what is ahead. They are on the long way up to a better life, but in the middle, they are frustrated because they, like us, prefer what is miserable to what is mysterious. Oftentimes, we would rather cling to what perhaps is even unhealthy than to embrace that which is unknown. And it's in these transitional moments, right? 5 generations making bricks, stuck in Egypt in slavery, and not even a month into their journey out, they're already upset and wanting to go back. And in these moments of transition, right, this can be where our faith, our trust in God, can either fall or flourish. And it really all depends on your perspective. In 2020, the things that you're navigating, the things that we're experiencing, this could be the year that actually helps your faith fall or actually encourages your faith to flourish. And your attitude really all depends on your altitude, where you can see how far down the horizon. The things that Moses saw, the things that he knew about God, helped him trust God through the wandering in the wilderness and through the grumbling of the people. And if you and I want to go further faster, if we want to get through this turbulent transition called 2020, we often have to change our altitude. I remember we were taking a plane flight back here to San Diego from Chicago when we lived there coming back for summer or Christmas holiday, I'm not entirely sure, but there was a storm that we were flying through, and the pilot came over the intercom and said, "Hey, ladies and gentlemen, we're experiencing some turbulence," which, you know, you already know that you're in turbulence before they let you know. But they say, you know, put your seatbelt on, the whole thing, we're gonna pause drink service. And we're actually going to take a pretty sharp, abrupt, you know, increase in altitude to get above this storm because it's clearer higher up. And I remember hearing that and thinking, how true is that for so much of our experiences in our soul, with our faith, with our relationships, that simultaneously two things were true, that at the altitude that we were at in that plane, it was rough. There was thunder and there was rain and it was an intense storm. But the pilot could tell on the radar that in the same space, just a little bit higher, there was clear skies and bright sun. And so he takes our plane up and we kind of feel the G-force, you know, in our body as we rise in altitude pretty aggressively. And yet all of a sudden it was calm and the lights came in the windows and you could hear this collective sigh of relief of the passengers on the plane. And I think so much of that experience resonates for how we engage with what's going on in our world around us, what's going on perhaps in your life and your relationships with your kids and their teacher on virtual schooling, or with your coworkers on the Zoom room call, or whatever it might be happening in your house right now, that there might be an altitude that you need to rise up where it is actually easier, it's cleaner. But to get there, the long journey to the promised land, the long way up, can often be a little bit jarring. It can feel a little bit intense. You can have that spiritual G-force pressing in on you, just like I felt on that plane. In fact, similarly, Jesus had this experience where he had come back to his hometown and he had kind of gathered this crowd in his house. And we check out this story in Mark chapter 2 that some friends of a guy that needed to get to Jesus got pretty creative and went to a higher altitude to get what they needed. It says this, that Jesus came back to Capernaum, and after several days, the news quickly spread that he was back home. So Jesus comes back and everybody wants to come see him. And the house that he was staying at, which most scholars believe was Peter's house, was so packed with visitors that there wasn't even room, even outside the door. And as he was teaching and preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They wanted to bring this person that was, you know, needing healing to Jesus. They had heard that Jesus could heal and they wanted to bring their friend to get healing, but they couldn't get to the door to bring him to Jesus because of the crowd. And so Mark records that he actually knows that they climbed to the roof and dug a hole and lowered the man down on his mat right in front of Jesus. Now don't miss this. It says, seeing their faith, Jesus looked at the paralyzed man and said, "My child, your sins are forgiven." But some of the teachers and the religious leaders that were sitting among them, they got frustrated and said, What is he saying? That's blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus knew what they were thinking. And so he turned his attention and asked these religious leaders, "Why do you question this in your heart? Isn't it easier to say to a paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, something ethereal and that no one really have any proof, you can't fact check it, it's just a nice thing to say. Isn't it easier to say to this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or stand up, pick up your mat and walk? And so I will prove to you that the Son of Man," referring to himself, "has the authority on earth to forgive sins," Jesus said. He turns to the paralyzed man again in front of him, coming through the hole in the roof, and says, "Stand up, pick up your mat and go home." And the man jumped up, Mark records, grabbed his mat and walked out through the stunned onlookers, leaving the house, and they were all amazed and they praised God, exclaiming, "We've never seen anything like this before." Now, again, most scholars believe this was Peter's house. Mark was Peter's protege. So when Mark records this for us, Peter's like, "I actually paid the repair bill. I know this happened." And we realize that in this story, these friends had a choice to make, right? They get to the house, they have their friend, they're trying to do a good thing, and they can't get in the door. They can't go through the conventional way. And they decide, "We have to go higher." They knew that in order to move forward, sometimes you have to go higher. In order for you in your life to move forward, you may have to go higher. In order for you to go, you know, further in your relationships or in your finances or for your faith to grow in this challenging time, you may have to go higher. Your attitude might have to elevate. Your perspective might have to shift. Your trust needs to grow. And that's what these friends knew when they came to the house and they wanted to do a good thing and bring their buddy who, you know, can't walk to Jesus to get healed. And they realize that something's in the way. They have a choice. They can give up or they can go higher. And so they decide to climb up onto a roof and dig through the roof of someone's house that they didn't know and lower their friend down in front of the one they had heard that can heal. And Mark records something so interesting in the middle of that verse. He says, when Jesus saw their faith. Now, scholars have, you know, debated over who they're referring to, but most agree that he actually looked up in that moment to the four men kind of peering through the hole in the roof and said, your faith has motivated me to engage with this young man, to this crippled person, to this paralyzed person on the mat, and to heal them. And to not just heal them physically, but to forgive his sins, much to the gasp of the religious leaders in the room. And this, I think, is so interesting, right? Is that Jesus doesn't push away the people that kind of moved in when there wasn't room. He actually honors them. That there were people that had their rightful spot and they were important and they were the religious elite and they were in the house. But these four friends decided to go higher, to be a little bit more creative, to be a little bit more desperate. And what they did actually was honored by the person of Jesus when they saw him heal their friend. Now, I don't know about what that means for you. I don't know what decision you might be facing right now where there's kind of the normal way forward. Maybe 2020 has just kind of worn down any energy or excitement or hope that you might have been feeling. And the idea of having to like kind of posture yourself up a little bit higher to kind of get above the fray, to navigate at a higher elevation so that you can see a little further down the horizon. Maybe that seems daunting to you, but I think this is the way of Jesus. As the people left the house that day, they weren't marveling at Jesus' teaching. They weren't marveling at, you know, the hometown hero coming back for a little bit of a reunion visit. They marveled at the faith of these friends. And my guess is that the people in your life, the people in mine, the people in our community and around San Diego or wherever it is that you're watching from, in this crazy cultural moment we find ourselves in, they're wanting to see people who live this kind of faith. They're wanting to see people who are willing to kind of press past maybe their comfort zone to honor other people, to serve other people, to make a difference and go beyond what just feels catatonic and kind of crippling for many of us in this season. In fact, the folks that were watching, Jesus' disciples that were looking on in that moment, Peter specifically and John, the person whose house those men ripped through the roof to lower their friend, and they had their own moment later after Jesus was crucified and resurrected and went back up to heaven. We read in the book of Acts as the church is kind of getting launched that they actually believed Jesus when Jesus told them, hey, you're going to do even better things than I am. You're going to be able to do the things that you've seen me do and even greater things. And so in Acts chapter 3, this story picks up. Check this out. It says, one day at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Peter and John were on their way to the temple for a prayer meeting. Now, I love this because it doesn't say what day it was. It was just an average day. If it was the typical temple gathering day, it would have said so. And so they're just kind of hanging out, walking around. And at the same time, on the way to the temple, they bump into a man crippled from birth being carried up. Now, every day he was set by others at the temple gate, the one named Beautiful, it says, and he was there to beg from those going into the temple, right? So he knows, hey, these people are going in, they're trying to make it right with God. If I give them an opportunity to give to me on the way in, maybe I'll get lucky because they want to like, hey, remember that guy out there that I gave some money to? He's there asking for a handout, and Peter and John come up to him, and he asks them for something. And Peter, with John at his side, looked him straight in the eye and said, hey, look up here. And this guy on the ground looks up at Peter, probably expecting to get something from them. And Peter says, I actually don't have a nickel to my name, but what I do have, I give to you. And so in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. He reaches down, he grabs the man by his right hand, and he pulled him up. And in an instant, this young man who was paralyzed from birth, his feet and ankles became firm. He jumped up to his feet and walked. And the man went away into the temple with them, walking back and forth, dancing and praising God. And then check out this refrain. And everybody there saw him walking around and praising God. They recognized him as the same one who is out there sitting at the temple gate, Beautiful, begging, and they rubbed their eyes astonished, barely believing what they saw. They had never seen anything like this. And Peter and John had this exact same experience where they realized that because of the power of God at work in their life, they were able to replicate what Jesus himself did. because they had this experience where their elevation, their altitude changed their perspective. They went higher in order to go further, that they realized that God might want to use them in spite of what they didn't have. I love that Peter was honest and said, I don't have what you want, but what I do have, I want to give to you. And here's my challenge for us, is don't let what you don't know keep you from doing what you can do. Don't let what you don't know keep you from doing what you can do. Don't let what you don't have keep you from doing what you can do. Don't let the challenges of this year and this pandemic and all the ways that it hasn't turned out the way we had hoped keep you from doing what really matters to you. I think this pandemic has actually given all of us permission to really refocus and ask the big questions of what do I really care about in my life? And it's also given us permission to release and let go of the things that we were just doing out of habit and don't really serve us all that much. But my hope is for many of us is that we won't get dislodged from our purpose or from hope in this context, but we will actually find a commitment that's deeper to the things that matter most to us in our life. Things like faith, family, real relationships, and deep community. And all those unnecessary peripherals, they'll lose their luster. But to do that in this space of transition, in this kind of snow globe fog of 2020, we have to get really clear on what it is that God is inviting us into. We shared last week that in order for us to move forward in these new days, there has to be new ways for us to engage. There's new ways for us to engage individually, for you to engage financially, for you to engage as a church. And I just want to give you a couple of them. And these might seem really small, but these are things that you could actually do to partner with us as Restoration Church, wherever you are watching right now, that you could do safely from your home and you could engage in a way that actually moves our mission forward of empowering all people to love and follow Jesus. Things like you could fill out a Yelp review. You could fill out a Google review of our church. When we're rated on those platforms, it actually increases our awareness. And especially right now in this pandemic, when people are searching for churches exclusively online, that's a huge way for you to help. There's ways for you to serve digitally from a distance, to monitor a chat room or to engage right now during our gatherings. There's ways for you to kind of step in and actually become a part of the solution for other people that are facing challenges in their life right now because of financial realities if you have an opportunity to give above and beyond. There's places where you could join a house church or a digital watch party and create community for others that might feel extraordinarily isolated. Things like subscribing to our YouTube page and sending out those links to friends, you never know how God might use that little small thing that you might do to change someone's life. There's plenty that we don't have. There's plenty that we don't know. There's plenty that we feel we lack in this season. But my hope and encouragement is that we would not let what we don't have or what we don't know keep us from doing what we know we can do. What you can do right now, even right there as you sit, as you engage and learn from God's word about what he might be inviting you specifically into. See, as we navigate 2020, we need to get above the noise and the chatter. We need to rise above and elevate our perspective so that we can see further and go further. And so what does that look like for you? What does that look like in your conversations with your friends? What does that look like with your parenting of your kids? What does that look like with virtual school or in your finances or in your job or on the Zoom call? For many of us, this disorienting feeling of the pandemic life that is 2020 has felt new and it has felt challenging. But my encouragement to you is that you've been through transitions before. You actually are familiar with what this feeling is. And even though none of us like it, we actually all know that if we choose to grow through it, we may look back and tell the story of 2020 that might be where God developed and grew and blessed your life and your faith, maybe more than ever before. But it always is a little bit of a long way up. And so that's my hope and my encouragement for you, specifically for this week, is that you would not resist the mystery of the unknown, but that you would accept the invitation of God to walk with him even the long way around. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, thank you for the reality that you are not unfamiliar with non-linear living and that you like to take us on journeys even if it makes us uncomfortable. And so I pray for those right now that are just feeling disoriented or frustrated They're frustrated with the mystery, and they're wanting to reach back for something that might have been less healthy or more miserable if they're honest. Would you speak hope into their heart and entice them and invite them forward by your Holy Spirit, that they would hear you, that they would want to rise higher so they can see further, and that we as a community, as individuals, as men, women, children, and as Restoration Church, we would not let the things that we do not have or that we do not know keep us from doing what we know we can. Would we lean in together? Would we build this church and accomplish the vision that you've given us together? It's in your name we pray, amen. Well, I want to encourage you, for those of you that call Restoration Church your home, right now there's an easy action step for you to actually move our mission forward, to partner with us, and that is through our worship of giving. That we actually enjoy giving back to God here as a community, not because we're paying God off or paying Him back, but because we understand that everything we have is actually a gift from our loving Heavenly Father. And when we are entrusted with much, we want to give back and say thank you. And it keeps our grip on our stuff loose enough that God can move in our life. And so if you're here and this is your church home and you have the capacity to give, I know many of us are facing different economic realities right now, but if you are able to give, I want to encourage you. There has never been perhaps a more influential time where your giving makes a tangible difference in people's lives. And so you can give a couple ways around here. You can give online and set up one time or reoccurring giving at restorationchurchsd.com/give. You can grab your cell phone right now and text any amount in the message to the number 84321 and then simply follow the text prompts that you'll get back to select Restoration Church as your giving destination. Or you can mail a check here to our building in San Diego. But however it is that you give, we want you to know that not only does it honor God, but it actually moves our mission forward and it helps us to empower all people to love and follow Jesus. And I believe that in the midst of the craziness of this time, as scarce as things might feel or as much pressure as you might be under, perhaps generosity is the move that will help bring clarity to what really matters in your life. And so through your giving, God will bless you in surprising and perhaps even unexpected ways. So thanks for joining us today. We're going to continue to worship through one more song. Our creative team is going to lead us, and then our host will be here to wrap us up. Thanks for joining us today at Restoration Church Online.
Living, breathing proof that I am true.
real to the bone. You speak light to the soul, and I'm swept away. Thank you again so much for worshiping with us today. We loved gathering together, and what a powerful message. We pray that that is going to encourage you and empower you as you step into this next week. And we wanted to end our time together with just a quick prayer for those in our community who've been affected by the fires that have swept all over our state. We have gotten prayer requests from some of you that have had to evacuate, and we know many of our families, even here within our Restoration Church community, the Bunsold family and the Davis family, who have firefighters who are bravely stepping into these spaces to be heroes in our communities. So we wanted to pause and pray for those of you who have been affected by the California wildfires. So pray with me. God, we just thank you so much for your protection and your provision over so many. God, our hearts ache as we think of those who've lost their homes, of those who have been displaced or evacuated. God, and we just ask for your protection and your continued blessing over those who are stepping courageously in to fight these fires, God. Even members of our own community, like Robert Bunsold and Kevin Davis. God, we just ask for your protection over them, over their teams, over all the many brave men and women who are stepping out as firefighters to fight these fires, to help regain control over the devastation as going across our state, God. I just pray for your peace and your protection to cover all of those who've lost their homes. And Lord God, you are near to the brokenhearted. And so we take you at your word, and we just trust you, Lord, as we lift up these families, as we lift up these brave men and women. God, we just ask for your continued blessing and restoration over the lives and neighborhoods and cities that have been damaged by these wildfires, Lord. Thank you for your church. I pray for more ways for us to step in, to be your hands and feet, to see our neighbors, to comfort them. And Lord, ultimately we pray that you would be near to those who are scared and fearful, and those who have lost their homes, God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Well, thank you, friends. We are just amazed at the ways that God uses ordinary men and women like you and me to do this work of restoration in our city. And we believe that better days are in store. We love hearing stories. We love seeing your posts. So as God is moving, we encourage you to post on Instagram, to post and share your stories with us. We want to be able to share what it is that God is doing in these wild and crazy days. So we hope you'll mark and save the date for October 4th as we prepare to gather again in person for our parking lot gathering here at Restoration Church at our building. So until we see you again, whether in person or online, we pray that because of Jesus, you would experience restoration here in San Diego as it is in heaven. We love you. We'll see you next week.
Smooth rhymes, I'm usually overthinking with my mathematic mind. Let's press rewind and take it back, go take it back to when I was younger. I could take the world under my arm and go farther than I thought I could. Now I'm a rider, not a fighter. I wanna love, I wanna show the world what I'm dreaming of. Breaking chains from the slaves and calling people by name, telling them they're worth it. Change the earth if we try, try with just a little love. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We're the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things. I don't know how to do this, maybe I've just been running my mouth lately, wondering how to take a stand. I'm just trying to be a better man, we'll change our mind if we take the time to listen. Open up our eyes to something new, see what different people can do. Like remember when we were kids and trouble didn't seem so big. Let's see the world with wonder again. Never let those monsters win. We're taking down the big guys. We ain't giants, but we're reaching towards the sky, higher than they said we could. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things. We're the sculptors making shape. The poets turning phrases into weapons, big enough to make a difference. Though our voices may be small, we're breaking down the walls and we're lifting the broken up. Because we are the music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things. Because we are music makers. We dream impossible dreams. We are the artists and the planet shakers. We are here to change things.